then the Tofarian, the Kentuckian, Dynasty of the Jew Christ our God. And we leave Bethlehem, but we leave Bethlehem to go to the Jordan River. The festival period still remains with us. This week is a fast-free week, except Saturday, strict fast day this coming Saturday, since the eve of the Holy Theophany. The Theophany falls next Sunday, January 6th, one of the 12 great feasts of the Church. And so it's a double feast that we celebrate. Originally in the Church, there was one feast day, it was January 6th, and the Nativity of the Lord and the baptism of the Lord was commemorated on that one day. And then later, December 25th, became separate as the celebration of the incarnation of Christ. But both feasts speak of the same thing. Both feasts speaks of the manifestation of Christ to the world. In this feast of the Nativity, we see Christ coming as a little child, as a newborn king, in the cave in Bethlehem. In this feast, we see Christ as the Son, S-U-N, of righteousness. The hymnology says he's the Orient from on high. He's the day spring. He's the dawn. The Feast of the Theophany speaks of Christ as the illumination, as the light of light. In other words, this Feast of the Nativity we celebrate is the dawn. After the darkness and shadow, light comes. But the light isn't the sun yet. That is just the first light. Nativity is the first light, as it were. Theophany is the sunrise itself. And why is that? Because if Christ comes and is born, it's for a purpose. The purpose is made manifest on the Feast of Theophany, when our Lord is baptized in the Jordan River. In the Feast of Nativity, we see Christ himself, the God-man as a little child. In the Feast of Theophany, what do we see? We see manifest the Holy Trinity for the first time in all creation. But the voice of the Father says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove overshadows the Lord, the manifestation of the Holy Trinity. And so this Feast of Nativity is great. The Feast of Theophany, in a certain sense, is even greater yet. Why? Because there is no light given to us. It's the incorporation of us into the purpose of Christ's coming. Think of it this way. If you're sickly, and you're in bed, and the physician is coming to your house, they don't do that anymore, but in the old days they did, and someone says, "Oh, the physician is here." You're of good cheer, because you know the physician is present. But you're even more joyous when he begins his medical procedures, when he's attentive to your particular needs. Somebody gives you a present, beautifully wrapped, you're happy with it. But you're all the more joyous when you open the present. It's the same thing with these double feasts of the Nativity and the Theophany. You go from one glory to another glory, from one joy to another joy. In the hymnology of the Church, it has the same sense of this. In the Feast of Nativity, we were singing, "Our Savior, the day spring from the east, has come and manifest himself to us. And shadow and darkness have receded away," in the hymn of light. In the Feast of Theophany, we sing the same thing, that Christ comes and manifests himself, and shadow and darkness, it fades away. In the great hymn, that prayer we will say next Sunday, at the great blessing of the water, immediately after the Divine Liturgy, the prayer of St. Sophronius, the Patriarch of Jerusalem, he says this. He says, "In the preceding feast, you saw Christ as the little child. In this feast, we behold Christ, fully grown, the manifestation of God, perfect God of perfect God." And so the sun rises. The sun rises and it gives light. It gives greater light than the dawn. The sun rises and it gives warmth. The sun rises and it gives illumination. And this Feast of Theophany we're going to enter is called the Feast of Lights, the Feast of the Holy Illumination. Why illumination? Because by the Holy Spirit, we're given the sense of what is of high. This Feast of Theophany revealed to us the Holy Trinity of persons. The Feast of Theophany will see Christ being baptized in the waters, the symbol of washing away of our personal sins by his baptism. The Feast of Theophany will begin the public ministry of our Lord. For 3 years he will preach and teach, and he will baptize. He himself doesn't baptize. Christ never baptized, but he sent his disciples to baptize, and they baptized in his name. And this is even before his resurrection. And so the feast that is coming is all glorious for us. But what does the gospel say today, particularly about this forthcoming feast? Well, it says that John the Baptist is there. And John the Baptist is preaching a baptism of repentance and the confession of sins. The people are coming to Jordan and they're being immersed. Remember, baptismo, it means immersion. This is how we baptize, immersion, fully covered with water. And John is preaching this baptism. But it's not just baptism, it's the baptism of repentance. Matania, repentance, a radical change. In other words, it's not enough just to confess one's sins, one has to be sorry for one's life and how one is living. And this is what John's preaching was all about. And the crowds would come, and in Luke's gospel we see this delineated. The crowds would say, what am I to do to be saved? John the Baptist said, well, you need to be baptized, but you need to do more than that. You have to show the fruits of repentance. You have to show that you're willing to change. They said, well, how do we do that? And he would say, well, if you have two shirts, give one shirt to somebody who has none. If you have extra food, give the extra food to somebody else. And the tax collectors, they would say, what are you doing? Well, the tax collectors, when they collected money, they often were dishonest. They had a bad reputation. They took more money than was needed, and they pocketed. So St. John the Baptist says, be honest. Don't take more money than you're supposed to when you collect taxes. And the soldiers say, what about us? John the Baptist said to the soldiers, he says, don't slander anyone. Don't be dishonest. Be content with your pay. Be honorable in your service. And so there was a preaching and teaching about repentance, about the need to change. It wasn't just going into the water and being washed and cleansed, but there had to be repentance. But it's the same thing for us. One can go to confession, and that's a second baptism. We call confession the sacrament of repentance, a second baptism. We can confess our sins, but it's not enough. We need to be repentant. We need to be sorry for those sins. We have the firm purpose of amendment, with the grace of God, not to commit those sins again. The baptism of Jesus is different, though. The baptism of Jesus is not just repentance, but as the first words of our Lord teaches, repent, for the kingdom of God is here. It's at hand. These are the first words that our Lord speaks in his public ministry, to change our ways. Repentance is something that we do all the time. It's a 24/7 endeavor. It's not just for certain seasons. It's not just for Lent. Our whole life should be a time of repentance. But the baptism of Jesus, he gave us more than the baptism of John. The baptism of John, people confessed their sins. The baptism of Jesus, their sins were remitted. They were taken away. So when people were baptized by John in the Jordan, their sins weren't taken away. Only God could take away sin. And it had to be our Lord Jesus Christ himself, in his baptism, that takes away sin. John the Baptist is the last of the prophets. All the prophets of the Old Testament, they were preaching and teaching the same thing. Repent, go back to God, leave your evil ways, be on the right path, be on the straight way with God. John the Baptist is the last of the prophets. He's saying the same thing. He's closing the Old Testament, and he's opening the New Testament, the New Covenant. And so we prepare ourselves to go into this feast. This feast in which we ourselves have experienced holy baptism. The baptism of water, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of fire. The baptism of water, it's clear, we go in. We're saturated with water. We're outwardly cleansed. But also we're inwardly cleansed. It's a cleansing of the soul. For any stain of sin, it's all cleansed, it's purified, it's washed away. That's what water does. But it's also the power of the Holy Spirit. And John's baptism didn't have the power of the Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit give us in baptism? Well, it gives us himself. The Holy Spirit comes and consecrates us. We become spirit bearers. That our body, our soul, our mind, our will, it becomes the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's just not the body, but it's the soul, it's the will, it's the affections, it's everything about us. Just like in the temple, there's a building, but there's all kinds of furnishings and adornments in it. It's the same thing with us. We're not just body and soul, but we're will and mind and we're spirit. And all these things are Christified. The seal of the gift of the Holy Spirit is put upon us, on our eyes and forehead and ears and lips and cheeks and chest and hands and feet, and even our inner self in our heart when it's put on our breast. It means our soul, it means our heart. When it's put on our forehead, it means our thinking, our contemplation, our meditation, our inspiration. And so we become Christified and sanctified. For the Holy Spirit, he gives us the spirit of truth. He makes known to us the divine teachings. He illuminates us with understandings that are necessary for our salvation. But the Holy Spirit is poured out upon us. The Lord says you receive the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we're empowered. We're made strong in the Holy Spirit. That we're abiding in the Holy Spirit. And the image of God that is imprinted upon us, the likeness begins to become manifest through the power of the Holy Spirit. So there's illumination besides cleansing. But what about fire? The Lord says in two of the Gospels, Matthew and Luke, that you'll be baptized in water, the Holy Spirit, and fire. Well, what is this fire? Well, the fire, again, is the work of the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit is a fire. And what the Holy Spirit does, he transforms, he refines us, he transfigures us, he makes us into something that we're not. This is shown very clearly in one of the prophets, Malachi. Malachi, in his writing, is saying that there's gold and there's silver. But the gold and the silver, it's not pure yet. It's in the ore. That the refiner, the person who refines the metals, he has to take this, and he has to put it into the fire. And the fire purifies it, it refines it, and it comes out as pure gold and pure silver. And so the prophet Malachi says, this is for us, that we're to be pure gold and pure silver by the work of the Holy Spirit, the fire of the Holy Spirit, so that we shone with the brilliance of the grace of righteousness. And so fire means for us a transformation, a refining, so that we become pure gold, pure silver, which means virtuous, which means righteous, which means godly. And so all this is given to us in this forthcoming feast of the Theophany of our Lord. And all this has already been given to us existentially and personally when we were baptized. It's only for us to continue in that path, to increase the measure of grace that we've received. And so let us begin to look to the Jordan. As we leave Bethlehem, we advance to the Jordan. And we see all that graciousness, all that salvific doings that the Lord is going to open up to us. The Christ child was a king. But the king, he's only happy if there's a kingdom. And there's royal sons and daughters in his kingdom. The Feast of Theophany is the manifestation of that kingdom. The kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is here. And we're called to be members of that kingdom, citizens of that kingdom, to rejoice in the kingship of Christ, and to dine at the royal banquet with him and the eternal Father.